the press would report the crowd like it is. And you've got thousands of people outside trying to get in, and they can't get in. This is one hell of a big stadium, I tell you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a great honor. Jacksonville, great place. How's your football team going to be? Good, good. I hear good things. I hear good things. So I want to start by saying that early this morning, I turned on the television, and I saw that our country took $400 million in cash, but different currencies, different places, different representatives representing those places, took $400 million, put it in airplanes, and flew it over to Iran. And folks, how stupid are we? How stupid are we? What's going on in this country? How stupid are we? And then you say, I wonder what happens with that $400 million. I wonder who ends up getting it, right? I wonder who ends up getting it. So sad. And people tried to stop it, and a lot of people, you just wonder, who's making decisions like this where you take $400 million, they put it in small containers, and probably pretty large containers, actually, and they bring it over to Iran. And you say, who's making these decisions? Whose decision is that? That's all emanating from one of the worst deals ever made in this country, the deal we made with Iran, and that probably was hostage money to get hostages out for $400 million, because it was exact timing. Our leaders are incompetent. And that's why we have these crowds. That's why we have these crowds. That's why we fill up the stadiums, no matter where we go. It's this way. We have unbelievable people in our country. We have great, great people in our country. And you see things like that. You see a deal. Speaking of great people, speaking of our best people, we have, and I just visited with some incredible folks. I have no idea where they're sitting, but I know they have a good location. Some really amazing gold star families. Where are they? Where are they? Where are they sitting? Here one. Here are they. Here they are. Incredible people. Incredible people. We have amazing people in our country. We have amazing leaders. By the way, General Flynn, how great is he? That's the guy we want. First time I saw him, I met him at a ballroom. They were honoring a certain person. Never changes. It's getting better because Bernie's not here. Nobody has any spirit for Hillary. Nobody. But General Flynn, I met him in a ballroom because somebody was being honored. You know who it was? It was me. And from the day I met him, I was impressed. He's tough, he's smart, he's great. And we're going to get people like that very actively involved with us. Very actively. So I want to thank General Flynn for being here. So this is the way we wake up in the morning, and every day it's something else. And it goes to show what's happening with our country. We're not going to let it happen anymore. We're going to get elected November 8th. Remember that. November 8th. And this is going to be a very important night. You know, we're here together. It's a family. It's a family. And you know what it is? It's a movement. This is a movement. There's never been anything like this. And it's a movement against a lot of things. Our biggest obstacle is the press. They're so dishonest. But they're totally dishonest. These are really bad people. I'll give you an example. I have to say, our campaign is doing so nicely. We are running so nicely. We have some of the finest people in our campaign. They are doing great. Look, here's what I just was handed 2 minutes ago. Dishonest liberal media, CNN's New Day, covered anti-Trump stories. 200 of which there really shouldn't be any, okay? You know, yesterday, speaking of it, a great gentleman, met me backstage in Virginia. We were in Virginia. Same thing, sold out, packed house. We had to send 5,000 people outside, couldn't get in. And this gentleman, an amazing guy, came to see me backstage. And he presented me with the purple heart. And an amazing man. And he said, "Mr. Trump, I want you to have this." I said, "But is it yours or is it a duplicate or you're not giving me?" He said, "I want you to have it. You're the one to lead this country. I want you to have this." And Lieutenant Colonel, he's a Lieutenant Colonel, an amazing guy. And I took it and I said, "I can't believe this. This is really one of the most beautiful things that I've ever received. And from the heart, so much from the heart. So much from the heart." And then the next day I see where the media is saying, "It's a replica, it's this, it's that." And it turned out his son was with him. He was a wonderful young guy, and his son was with him. And his son called, and he was absolutely so upset that those things were said, false stories that they were said. And actually, ABC Tom Lamas is probably back here someplace, but he covered it very nicely. And he spoke, and they talked about it. And it actually was his heart. I mean, you know, it's what it is. His purple heart. And I just want to tell you, it was so beautiful. And you know how it gets cheapened by the media so much. They cheapen things. They cheapen things. If they're on the other side, they just cheapen things. And it's so sad to see. And just a little while ago, I met with the Gold Star families. I met with 6 families that were it's just like incredible people. And a gentleman handed me a check. And he said, "You know, Mr. Trump, this is for your campaign." And I said, "You don't have to do that." He goes, "I do." He said, "It's more money, and I haven't even opened it yet. I don't think I'll tell you how much it is, actually. But he said, "It's more money." Wow. He said, "It's more money than we can afford. But I want you to have it for your campaign." And I think it's important. Where is it? Where are those families? Does anyone know? They're incredible. And I just thought it was amazing. And the love in that room the love in that room for this country is beyond belief, believe me. Gold Star families, the love in that room was so incredible. So, you know, it's been an amazing period of time for me. The people of this country are so incredible. Now what we need is leadership. Okay? So listen, so, dishonest liberal media, CNN's New Day covered anti-Trump stories, of which, honestly, they're mostly false, okay? It's like the commercials. You ever see these negative ads? She's done, Hillary, Crooked Hillary's done hundreds of millions of dollars of commercials. We haven't started yet. I think I've spent zero, and we're doing nicely. We just had a poll where we're up in North Carolina. We had another one. We're up in Florida. You know Florida. We haven't spent any money. And we just took in this month, I think it's $80 or $82 million, and a lot of it is in small money. I'm spending a lot for my own campaign. We're raising a lot of money for the Republican Party. And the money is coming in, which is doing great. But small contributions, I think it was $61 each. And few Republicans can do that. Maybe no Republican can do that. Because people want to see great things happen for our country. They're so invested and so in love with our country. So, but we have a problem with the media. CNN's New Day, and I'm not just talking about CNN, they're all bad. Honestly, they're all bad. I don't know what it is. Is it like inferiority complex? They are so bad. It's other things. I actually pretty much know. CNN said they covered anti-Trump stories 200 times more than the Iran story today, according to the Media Research Center, which is respected, I think. Who knows? 200 times, so we're talking about 400. You know, they cover me constantly, story after story after story. Mostly bad, you know, mostly bad. What would they do if I wasn't involved in this campaign? You wouldn't cover Hillary very much. That's boring, okay? That's very boring. Okay. So, we have a problem. What, you know what you have to do with the media? You have to bull your way through. You just bull through. And you do the best you can. And I actually said, with the horrible misrepresentation that's given me by the media, I mean, the New York Times is disgusting. The good news is it's failing. It'll be out of business within 3 years. That's the good news, okay? So, very bad. But, you know, my whole life I've had like probably 5 or 6 stories on the front page of the New York Times. Now I have like 2 a day. It's terrible. Well, it shows you that politics is more important than real estate, right? But we have to bull through it. And the amazing, look at this arena. If I would read my press, the phony press, the lying reporters, the disgusting people that work for the media, if I would read it, I'll tell you how many people, we have 16,000 people right now, and we have thousands outside. If I would read my press, you know what I'd say? I'd say we wouldn't have 40 or 50 people here. I really mean it. How do all these people? You know why? Because the people are smart. The people are smart. So true. So I just think it's like an amazing thing. We're on a journey together. It's a journey like has never taken place in this country, actually. They say, what do I know? That's what they say. They say a number, Bill O'Reilly, a number. Large number of those people, even if they dislike Trump, which they all do just about. But a large number of them said this is the single greatest political phenomenon they've ever seen. And they love that. So, amazing. Amazing. So we're going to do a lot of things for this country. We're going to bring back our jobs to start off. You know, this area has been devastated by your manufacturing jobs moving to Mexico and other places, all right? Not going to happen, folks. Not going to happen. Not going to happen. Some company wants to move to Mexico. We wish them a lot of luck. When they make their product and they want to sell it back into your area, into Jacksonville or anywhere else in the United States, they're going to pay a 35% tax to get the product back into this country. Okay? Not going to happen anymore, folks. I have a lot of friends that live in Jacksonville. I know why. So, you look at what's going on with our government. You look at the way our leaders are controlled by special interests. Our leaders are controlled by lobbyists that get a lot of money. I mean, I've hired some over the years, to all fairness. They do a very good job. But our leaders are controlled. So when it comes to trade, if you want to have a company and you want to keep the company from moving to another country, like Mexico, then let me tell you what happens. You go out, you hire your lobbyists, you work with the special interests. The politician has no chance. They do whatever their special interests want. And that's part of the beauty of what I'm doing. So I've spent, I guess, more than $60 million so far. Now, that sounds like a lot, but it's a lot less than other guys have spent, and they came in seventh place, okay? Well, maybe I watch it because it's my money as opposed to... But it's like, who would you rather have representing you? The guy that spent the least and comes out first, or the person that spends the most and comes out? Who would you? I don't know. I think I know the answer. So, if you look at your area, you need the one that comes out first. Hillary, by the way, her husband signed NAFTA, the single worst deal, maybe in the history of trade, but certainly in this country. Okay? Bill Clinton signed NAFTA. He cleaned you out. He cleaned New England out. He cleaned New York State out. He cleaned Ohio. You got to see Ohio, parts of Ohio. And by the way, we're going to take care of our miners. We're going to take care of our steel workers. We're going to take care of people that want to work, and they want to work where they want to work. We're going to have an amazing thing happen in November, you know. So Brexit, you probably saw what happened. So I called it right. I got zero credit, but that's okay. Everybody would say, oh, they'll never break up the UK. They'll never break up. They're never going to leave, right? They're never going to leave. The UK will never, ever leave. Well, guess what? You know what happened? They left. And I think the gambling odds were 20%. And they came up and they asked me, what do you think is going to happen? They're going to leave. Everyone said, why are you so sure? Because people don't want to be forced to take all these people in. You have the people coming from Syria. You have people from... Look at Germany. Look at what's happened to Germany. It's a total and complete disaster. Okay? A complete disaster. You look at what's going on in France. A friend of mine, I hate to say this, I like France, but a friend of mine goes to France every year, said, how is France this year? He says, France is no longer France. I don't go there anymore. It's no longer France. That's no longer France. City of Lights. No longer France, folks. So Hillary Clinton wants to bring people in by the tens of thousands into our country that we don't know who they are, where they come from. Not going to happen. Not going to happen, folks. It's not going to happen. We have enough problems. Soon we're going to be at $20 trillion in debt. Our debt has doubled under Barack Obama, who is grossly incompetent, who is a terrible president, and he is grossly incompetent. He doesn't know what the hell he's doing. Obama will not use the term radical Islamic terrorism. He won't use the term. He'll give a speech that lasts for a half an hour explaining why he shouldn't use the term. In the meantime, when I met with those incredible families backstage, they want that term used and they want to wipe out the problem because we have a big, fat, horrible problem. We're going to knock it out. So, we're going to knock it off, folks. You know, if you don't name what the problem is, if you're afraid to say what the problem is, if you don't want to talk about the problem, like Crooked Hillary, she said, well, you know, I forced her to sort of say this, but she hasn't used it yet. She said she would do it. She would do it. Well, so far she hasn't. But, folks, if you're unwilling to talk about the problem, you're never going to solve your problem. And believe me, that's the real deal. That's not the JV, like he said. That's the real deal. And, you know, when we fight our wars, we were talking about this backstage, we fight our wars in a very politically correct way. Okay, nice and easy. We have some incredible warriors like General Flynn. We have some incredible warriors who could get this problem taken care of. And fast. But we don't do what we have to do. And we're going to make our country safe again. And we're going to make our country great again, and we're going to have law and order, and we're going to respect our police, because you have to respect our police. We're not going to shoot our police. We're not shooting our police. It's never been so dangerous to be a policeman or woman. It's never been so dangerous. When you look at Dallas, when you look at all of the different places. 2 weeks ago in my speech, I named all these different cities where police people have been killed. Policemen, policewomen, they have been killed. Viciously, brutally killed. And the reason they were killed, they're doing their job. It's going to stop. Okay, it's gonna stop. We're gonna be more and more. It's gonna stop. And the police are gonna be careful. They're gonna be careful. We don't wanna have problems. We don't wanna do something wrong. Whether it's a mistake or you have somebody that has a really deep-seated hatred, which happens. You know, the biggest problem that we have. The police will do 100,000 unbelievable things. Nobody talks about it. If there's one mistake, whether it's intended or not intended, one mistake, that mistake is broadcast on the newscast for weeks. For weeks. And we can't make those mistakes. We can't make those mistakes. And we're not going to make those mistakes. But our police, we have to cherish our police. We wouldn't be here tonight without our police. And I will tell you, they and others, you know, I put the firemen, I put, I'll tell you, this groups, teachers, so important, teachers, so important, not recognized like they should be recognized. And by the way, speaking of teachers, we're going to get rid of Common Core, we're going to bring on education. The United States, out of the top 30 countries, the United States is just about last in education, right? And we're first in spending. And not only are we first, but we're first by a lot. Second doesn't even exist. We spend so much more per pupil than anybody else. So we're first in spending, and we're like number 30 in terms of the list. Okay. Now, other countries, Norway, Sweden, China, different countries, they're at the top, spend much less money than we spend. Wouldn't it be nice if we could turn it around? Wouldn't it be nice if we could be one of the top at least? Wouldn't it be nice? What a difference that would make. And obviously, our system is not working now. But we're going to get our system to work, okay? All right. So here's what we're doing. We're going to have strong borders. We need them. Without borders, we don't have a country. It's taller and taller every year, doesn't it? Taller. And I won't put you through the exercise. I'll tell you myself, Mexico is going to pay for the wall. You know, when I was on the stage not so long ago with some of the very good people, very talented people, some of the Republican candidates, and we were fighting over different things. You know, it's pretty vicious, they say, right? They say it was pretty vicious. They say it was the most vicious yet. Okay, the most vicious. That's not a good thing, but it's the way it is. Some people still haven't recovered, okay? But, well, I think this is more vicious because the press is more dishonest now than I've ever seen. Yeah. So I actually think this is more vicious. But, I'd have people come up to me, good people, politicians, they come up to me, you don't really mean, you know, after the debate, they say, you don't really mean we're going to build a wall, do you? I said, yeah. And they'd say, how do you do that? Well, we could start with precast plank. I'm so good at building. You know, we're building the old post office on Pennsylvania Avenue, right? We're 1 year, and we're actually more than that, but that's okay. We're 1 year ahead of schedule, significantly under budget, and the deal is a much more beautiful deal than we even envisioned. Higher quality materials, marbles. And I just left a place, a great place, I won't mention because it's a great city. Love the city. I was there 2 days ago. They have a hospital, a veterans hospital, that's $1.2 billion over budget. $1.2 billion over budget. It's not even that big a hospital. I looked at the building. I said, $1.2 billion? They should build it for one-third of that. Let alone, this is over budget, and that means it's going to be much higher than that. So we're going to put things in place. There are ways of building roads, bridges, hospitals, airports. You don't have to have cost overruns. We have massive, massive cost overruns, and we have to rebuild our country. Our roads are old and tired. I have a friend who's in the trucking business. He's one of the biggest guys in the trucking business. Good guy. And he said, Donald, is there anything we can do about the roads? I said, why? What's the problem? He said, there are so many bad spots. They call them bad spots. I call them potholes, right? He said, there are so many bad spots. And this guy has this incredible equipment, these beautiful trucks, the best, the best. He said, I'm destroying my equipment. We're going down those highways at 60 miles an hour, and we're hitting areas that just destroy these trucks. I say, have you ever seen it like that? He said, I've been doing this business for 40 years. It's never, ever been like this, okay? We are going to shovel ready. He said, shovel. Shovel ready, another Obama beauty. Shovel ready. Let's spend $1 trillion. We're shovel ready. I don't know, has any job been built? You know, shovel ready, another Obama beauty. But he said that. I have another friend. Okay, I have a lot of friends. I have another friend. He builds plants, right? Not the kind that grow out of the ground, the kind that are like rectangular and all. Big ones. Big, 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 big plants, the biggest. And he's just about the biggest in the world. And he builds them in the United States and he builds them in other countries. And I saw him not so long ago. I said, how are we doing? He said, I'm doing good. Company's good. I said, well, what's going on? Now, if this guy had to build an apartment, he wouldn't know where to begin, right? But a plant to build, you know, 1 million cars a year or whatever the heck they do, he has no problem with that. That's the greatest. He's a great guy, really talented guy, a brilliant guy and builder. So I said, so how are we doing? He said, not good. I said, how is your business? Great. I said, how does that work? Because you got to see what we're building in Mexico. We are building the greatest plants anywhere in the world. We are building plants. It's the eighth wonder of the world, what's going on in Mexico. Now I'm getting angrier and angrier in the meantime. Okay? We are building plants in Mexico. So I said, how are you doing in the United States? Not good. Not good. They're moving out of Michigan. They're moving to Mexico. They're moving out of Jacksonville. Let me tell you, while you're all standing here, and I appreciate you're all standing, but while you're all standing here, as you stand here thinking you have a good job, many of the companies in this area and areas all over our country are negotiating deals with management to move their plants out of the United States. NAFTA was the beginning of a disaster. TPP, which Hillary Clinton considered the gold standard, and then she heard me speaking about it one night, and she said, oh, I'm against it. But she's going to approve it. In fact, the governor of Virginia, Terry McAuliffe, who knows Hillary even better than her own husband knows her. He knows her better than us. This guy, Terry, winked at people and said, don't worry, TPP is going to be approved if she wins the election. They'll make a couple of changes, meaning like a comma. So this agreement is 5,000 pages long. Nobody's read it from our country. And yet these other countries, killers, they've digested every word, every comma, every sentence, every paragraph, everything. They know it, every single word. We don't have anybody that has even looked at it. Remember Obamacare, 2,500 pages. Do you remember Obamacare when nobody read it? Nobody. Nobody read it. Obamacare will be repealed and replaced. Okay? Nobody read it. Remember that? Not one politician, nobody read it. And you remember the guy that came out of one of the schools, Harvard, Yale, something? You remember the guy's a wise guy? And he thought he was in French, but they had the little cell phone camera on. He was among friends, but the friend certainly did a number on him and turned him in, and he was saying it's a whole joke, right? This was the designer of Obamacare. This was the man that sort of created Obamacare. And that's exactly correct. That's Harvey. That's exactly correct. So remember, you know, we tend to forget all these things, but we'll bring them up. But here you have a guy that said it's a phony deal. And yet we keep it. Remember this. On November 1st, new rates are going to come out. they're going to be astronomical. You know, in Texas, going through Blue Cross Blue Shield, they just had an increase of 60%, 60%. New rates are coming out on November 1st. The president wants to have that date delivered after. He wants it to be after, anytime after the election. Because it's election defined. The number that you're going to have to pay for your health insurance is going to be such an increase that it is election changing. Now, maybe I don't want the election changing, maybe I want it to be just the way it is. But it will send ripples through our society. It'll send ripples through our country. We can't let them delay. You know, they want to make that December 1st instead of November 1st. The election is on November 8th. When those numbers come out, it's going to be catastrophic. It's going to fail of its own volition. The country can't afford it, and the people can't afford it. Number one, the country can't. Number two, the people can't. It's got the double whammy. We will come out with something that will be so good, so much less expensive, so much better. It will be wonderful. Oh, we're going to take care of everybody. We're going to take care of everybody. So, when it comes to trade, we're going to make great deals. Carl Icahn endorsed me. So many people endorsed me. So many great business people. We're going to make great deals. They're going to be fantastic deals. Right now, we use political hacks to make our deals. We are going to make fantastic trade deals. Our jobs are going to start coming back. We're going to start making things again in this country. Okay, folks? We're going to make things in Jacksonville. We're going to make things all over Florida. We're going to make things in Ohio and Pennsylvania. We're going to make things in Michigan. We're going to bring our car companies back. We're going to make Apple iPhones in this country. You watch. And you know what I'm saying, and I don't have to play games. And we're not giving low interest loans that nobody needs, and we're not giving tax abatements, we're not giving any. We're going to just say, hey, you want to play games and you want to come into this country, or if you want to devalue your currency and destroy our companies, because that's what's happened. These countries are devaluing their currencies and they're destroying, totally destroying our companies and our jobs. And we're not going to let it happen because that's cheating, okay? That's called cheating. That's called cheating. I have friends that are manufacturers. They can't get their product into China. And if they do get it into China, they have a big tax to pay, right? With us, come on in. Come on in. We're the stupid country. Come on in. Come on in, everybody. Rob us blind. Take our jobs. Take our money. Rebuild China and many other places. Not going to happen, folks. It's not going to happen. It's over. It's over. We're not going to have trade deficits of $500 billion a year. We're not going to have a trade deficit overall of $800 billion a year and going up, okay? Almost $800 billion trade deficits, okay? Why does that have to happen? Why does that have to happen? So we're going to turn it around. We're going to turn it around. We're going to bring our jobs back. We're going to bring our manufacturing back. We're going to get you your other jobs. Remember this. One of the reasons that we have these full stadiums, this is beautiful. One of the reasons that we have these full stadiums is because many people in this room do not raise your hand. Do not raise your hand. You've been working harder now than you did 18 years ago. You made more money in real wages 18 years ago than you make today. And now, largely also due to Obamacare, you're working two jobs instead of one. We have part-time workers all over the place. The phony 5% number is a phony number. Because what happens is when people stop looking for a job because they give up, after 4 or 5 months, they can't find it. They stop. They're considered statistically employed. Okay? So your real number is close to 20% unemployment. And just take a look. This is all good. We have lots of problems. Our military is depleted. We're going to fix it. Our borders are bad. We're going to fix it. We're going to build that wall. Believe me. But we have lots of problems. But I'm not filling up stadiums because of problems. I'm filling them up because people don't have jobs. And they're not making as much money. How would you like to be working harder? You're older. You're not feeling as good. Although, I sort of feel as good as ever. I've been an awful lot. I think I feel better now than I did 25 years ago. You're inspiring. You're inspiring. I have a friend who said to me the other day, because I spoke and I guess it was 71 minutes, a long time, at the convention. The Republican convention, which I actually liked it. Didn't my kids do a good job? My wife, my kids. And I spoke for 71 minutes, but about 26 of those minutes were like standing ovations, right? It was like these massive standing ovations, and it was really great. And I have a friend who's a very successful guy, he's a strong guy, and he came up, he goes, could I ask you a question? Where do you get the energy? Where do you get the energy to do this? I said, do I have a choice? What am I going to do, stop and take a rest? And then come back an hour later and finish it up? I said, what do we, you know, but we do. You have energy when you love what you're doing. Now, I've always loved real estate, and I've always had a lot of energy. I've had great stuff. I mean, I built a great, great company, some of the greatest assets in the world, some of the greatest real estate assets in the world. But I built this great company, but I love doing it. I love doing this. I love seeing these crowds of people pour in. And I want to do, you know, somebody said, why are you doing it? And I say, because, seriously, we're going to make America great again. It's going to be easy. It's going to be easy. It's going to be easy. That's why I'm doing it. Believe me, I can think of other places I'd rather be. I can think of other places. But I'm having a good time being with my friends from this country. This country is so incredible. You know, we go to Oklahoma. We had 25,000 people. We had 21,000 people in Dallas. We had 35,000 people in Mobile, Alabama. Mobile, right? We had these massive crowds. And another friend said, how do you do that? How do you speak and you don't even have notes, or you don't even look down at your notes when you have, and you don't have a teleprompter, right? You don't have a teleprompter. And teleprompters are all right for certain types of speeches. You know, when you have a serious policy speech, I guess it's okay. But you don't have a teleprompter. Do you ever see Hillary Clinton?
There you go.
If she speaks in front of 24 people, she's got the teleprompter. So. Ladies and gentlemen of Jacksonville, thank you. This is Crooked Hillary Clinton. I'm going to rob you blind. I'm going to rob you blind. She always has teleprompters. In fact, I said to my people, you know, she reads the same speech or different speeches, but she reads. And she's always got teleprompters, even in like small groups. Look, let me tell you, if she came here tomorrow, so look at this place, packed, thousands outside, right? We actually put screens outside, thousands outside. So, Hillary, if she came here, if she had 500 people, I would be surprised. 500's not bad, right? So we have 16,000 plus, we have a lot of people outside. Look, if she had 500 people, I would be surprised. Now, I don't know. I hear we're leading Florida by a little bit. I don't know why we're not winning by a lot. I don't know. And maybe crowds don't make the difference. Maybe they don't make the difference. But here's the thing. So we're going to make great trade deals. We're going to put up the wall. The wall's going to work. Believe me. The border guards, the border agents, these are incredible people. They endorsed me, 16,500 endorsed me. Sheriff Joe Arpaio. Thank you. Sheriff Joe. Tough cookie. Good guy. Actually, good heart. Sheriff Joe endorsed me. He knows more about borders than anybody in the history of the world, I think, right? I think he's been working the border for 50 years or something, he told me. This guy knows borders. He endorsed me. Endorsed me early. National Rifle Association endorsement. Big endorsement. We get tremendous support from the evangelical community, from the religious community. And we're going to give them back their right of speech. You heard that. Lyndon Johnson in the 1970s put in language that keeps our pastors, our ministers, our priests, our rabbis from speaking. Can't speak because you lose your tax exemption if you do. You can't have, think of it. They put it in. And I said to them in a meeting, I could see there was like love in the room. I had tremendous religious leaders. And they support me. And they like me. I know when people like me and when people don't, believe me. I'm very good at it. They like me. You know, I won with even, remember, I was going to lose in South Carolina, big evangel, and I won big. I was going to lose in different areas. We won. We had such unbelievable support, evangelical support, tremendous evangelical support. But I asked them, we are going to take out the language because basically they're being silenced. And I don't want my minister or my pastor to be silenced. I think they should have a right to speak. And that goes for all religions. So we're going to get that taken out. Very important. And remember this also. That to me is very important. If you're religious, if you're any, I mean really any evangelical, I say. But if you're Jewish, anybody, we're going to get it taken out. It's very unfair. It's really free speech. I actually pointed to them in the room when they were telling me this. And because they said, we can't get involved politically. I said, that's too bad. And I pointed, I was in a building, one of my buildings in New York, where there had been a conference room. I pointed down on the street. I said, that means that any one of those people on the street have more power than you. Any one of those people, they have more power than you do because they can say what they want to say. It's very unfair. I found it to be very unfair. And you look at religion, what's going on in this country, and it's not fair, and it's having a hard time. And it's having a hard time because they're not allowed to speak. And we're going to give them the right to speak. So you got to go vote. And I have to tell you, the last time, evangelicals did not vote. If they voted, it could have been a much different election. They did not vote. And you know, when you think of the power, when you think of the power, think of it as a group of people. Women, 50%. Men, 50%. Religion, probably like 80%, 80, 85%. Think of the power. And it's good power. It's positive power. And we're going to make sure that works. So listen. Supreme Court justices, if you dislike me intensely, if you say, I would never in a million years vote for Donald Trump, you have to. You have no choice. You have no choice. Sorry. Because when Crooked Hillary puts Bernie recommendations on the Supreme Court, we've got ourselves another Venezuela, folks. We're going to have a Venezuela, and it's going to be bad. So you have Justice Scalia, and I put together a list from Heritage, from some of the great groups, right? From some of the great, great groups. We put together a highly recommended list of high quality, the highest quality judges. And we picked 11. Possibly we'll put four more, we'll have 15. We're going to pick from outside or inside of that group. These are people respected by, I mean, really, by all sides. I mean, they're respected people. And we're going to put them in. We're going to put them in as Supreme Court judges. Now, before we even start, we have Judge Scalia. So Justice Scalia was a great one. And we would have never, right? We went to the Federalist Society, highly respected people. That's what they do more than anything, what they do. And they recommended these people, and they're recommending a few more. And we're going to pick from that group, and we're going to have unbelievable justices of the Supreme Court. So important. And honestly, it's one of the most important things that can happen in this election. And it could be that this president, whoever the next president is going to better be. It could be that our next president, and hopefully it will be, you have to go out and vote on November 8th, or it's not going to be. But it could be that this president will have 3, 4, and maybe even 5 choices. It could break the all-time record for choices during the 14th, because that's the way the cards seem to be falling. So it looks like it's going to be a minimum of 3. I mean, on your first day, you have 1 because you're replacing Justice Scalia. So important. You have to do that. You have to do that. So here's what's going to happen. Here's what's going to happen. Our country, thank you. He says you're going to win, but the country doesn't. So, by the way, I can't stress, it's just so important. You have to go, you have to do it for that reason. You have to do it for that reason. Now, thank you very much, I appreciate it. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you. Who said that? Who said that statement? Somebody in there. Very nice, thank you very much. That's very nice. Well, it is a sacrifice. Look, we're all making sacrifices. We want our country to be great again. Look, we don't win as a country. We have a depleted military, we have great people, we have a depleted military. It's been starved for money. At a time when we just about, in our history, need it the most, right? We have people out there that want to do tremendous harm to us. We have leaders that are incompetent. We have leaders that don't know what they're doing. I'll give you an example. I said about NATO. I said, well, wait a minute, it's obsolete. Everybody laughed. They thought it was funny. Thank you. I said about NATO, it was asked of me by one of the very good commentators, actually. But I said about NATO that it's obsolete. Now, I mean, I have to admit, I'm not a student of NATO. I did deals. They came out of my ears. Deals. Buildings. That's what I did for years, and did well, and built this great thing. But you know what? I have common sense, and I have business sense. So, I said, what do you think of NATO? Why do you think? But I know. Funny. And they said, what do you think of NATO? I said, it's obsolete. I said, it's obsolete. And why is it obsolete? Because it doesn't cover terrorism. We need terrorism covered. Everybody laughed. They had a good time laughing. Ha, ha, ha. Isn't that funny? It's obsolete. Turned out that like 4 days later, after they stopped laughing, people that were very close to it said, you know what? Trump's right. Trump's right. And then a few weeks later, on the front page of the Wall Street Journal, there was a big story. And it said something to the effect that NATO to open terrorism unit. Right? I said, wow, that's good. That's good. And one of their top people, probably a very good person, one of their top people to be named as its head. Great. I said, wow, they're making some progress. That's good. Now, in the story, they only mentioned me in about a half a sentence, maybe even less. I think about an eighth of a sentence. They said something like, Donald Trump wasn't happy. Okay, that's fine. At least they mentioned me. Normally they don't. Then I also said, NATO, they're not paying their bills. I wasn't even sure, but I had read something, and it makes sense. Because I said, why would they pay their bills when nobody else pays us what they owe us? Including, by the way, the United Nations. Okay? When was the last time you saw the United Nations make a settlement of some war? You don't see it. It's like a country club, folks. And we're spending a fortune, and it can have a tremendous use. It can be a great thing. I'm not knocking it. But right now, it's like a country club. We pay for a tremendous percentage of it, and we always get
the wrong end of it. We are, I almost said, I don't know. We're getting the wrong end of it. It's a United Nations. But anyway, so then we talked about NATO, and I said, no, no. NATO, you have 28 countries, and the countries, many of them aren't paying what they're supposed to be paying. And I want them to pay. I want them to pay. If they don't pay, what are we doing? Sort of funny. We're defending them, and they're not paying. Figure that one out. So we're defending, and then I said, no, they got to pay. So the newspapers left that out, Washington Post in particular. They left that out about the payment. They said, Donald Trump wants to get rid of NATO. I don't want to get rid of NATO. But you always have to be prepared to walk. It's possible. Okay? Then they said, what happens if one of these countries, take a smaller one that nobody in this room's ever heard of, gets attacked by Russia? Are you saying you're not going to protect them? I say, well, let me ask you, have they paid? Have they paid? And a lot of these countries are very rich countries. A lot of these countries have good money. But they don't pay. You know why? Because nobody asks. I know store owners like that. They don't ask. They don't get paid. You know what they do? They go up to the president or whoever it is in the country, and they say, we owe the United States millions of dollars. And he goes, did they ask us for the money? No, they haven't. Don't pay it. I'm just going, yeah, why not? Why should you pay it? So you have this case where they don't pay. So I said, obsolete. They're working on that. But you need different countries. Because for terrorism, we're talking about a whole different group of countries. Okay? The terrorism that we know. Meaning radical Islamic terrorism. So we're going to say, unfortunately, they're going to pay. And if they don't, sorry. Then the people would say, the stupid people back there. They say like this. They go like this. They go, but we have a treaty to protect these countries. We have a treaty. I said, that's right. And we have a treaty where they're supposed to be paying and they're not paying. So we've got to go. Now, it sounds cold. And by the way, the commander in NATO, of NATO, who I must say, General Flynn has a lot of respect for. The commander of NATO last week said these countries have to pay. I like this guy. I'm going to like this guy. He said they have to pay. And he went in and he met with the countries and he said, hey, listen, we're getting a hard time. But you know what? You have to pay. Because if you don't pay, you can't do it anymore. Because, you know, the United States, we have to pay our bills. You have to pay your bills too. So here's the story. I don't want to sound cold. You know the kind of money that this country could be taking in to solve these massive, massive, massive budget problems that we have as a country. We have Japan. We take care of Japan militarily. They pay, according to a certain general that gave a big talk, they pay 50% the cost of what was spent. So this general said, does Mr. Trump not understand that Japan is paying 50% the cost of what it's costing to defend them? And I get a call from a reporter. Well, Mr. Trump, they're paying 50%. I said, why don't they pay 100%? Why are they paying 100%? Right? Why 50%? So we're defending Germany. We're defending South Korea against the maniac next door. I mean, you know, these are serious, like, defenses. Do you know, and I love Japan, I love the people of Japan, I'm friends with somebody, but do you know, and by the way, they can't even believe they get away with this stuff. In all fairness, they used to tell me all the time, but once I ran for president, they're saying, no, I think it's a fair deal, you know, this way. They want their country to do well. But you know that if Japan is attacked, we have to get involved probably with World War III, right? If we're attacked, Japan doesn't have to do nothing. They can sit home and watch Sony television, right? Sure. So we protect Germany. We protect numerous countries. We protect Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia has nothing but money. They were making $1 billion a day when the prices were high. Now they're making a lot. We protect them. We have military bases, we pay rent. Now you tell me, why are we paying rent? We have bases to protect them, we're paying rent. If we weren't protecting Saudi Arabia, they wouldn't be there for 2 months. And you know who wants Saudi Arabia? Iran. We've made Iran powerful. We've made them rich and we've made them powerful. And that's why they're in Yemen. And when I said, and when some of these people asked the question, why, when they made this horrible deal, one of the worst deals ever made, the Iran deal, why didn't you include Yemen? We're fighting them in Yemen. And the reason they want Yemen is because of the border to Saudi Arabia, because they want the oil from Saudi Arabia. They want Yemen, they want the border, because the border is massive, right along Saudi Arabia. They want to go in. Okay. Now, if we don't protect Saudi Arabia, they're not going to be there very long. But the question is, so why didn't you work out the deal when you made this horrible deal with Iran that we stopped the fighting in Yemen? And you know what Secretary Kerry said? He said, who's really just an offshoot of Hillary? He said very strongly after he recovered from his bicycle race where he fell and broke his leg. That was another beauty. Can you imagine these killers on the other side, these killer negotiators? The Persians are great negotiators. Can you imagine these killers on the other side? Where the hell is the Secretary of State? Oh, he's in a bicycle race. He just fell and broke his leg. He even had the little patches. You know the little patches? You know the patches with different companies on them. And he's laying in the street, our Secretary of State, with a broken leg. And I always say, I promise you, I give you my solemn oath that I will never, ever be in a bicycle race during a major negotiation. Ever. Ever. So they said, why didn't you... One of the guys right back there, that one right there. Why didn't you make a deal with Yemen? And you know what his answer was? It was too complicated. Too complicated. Too complicated. And it took forever to make this deal to start off with. Okay. Here's the story, folks. Thank you for coming out. November 8th is very important. You got to get out and you got to go. Florida is sold. They're going to spend a lot of money on phony ads. And we did it once before. Don't forget, in the primaries, I was hit with every nasty ad. I couldn't breathe. I wanted to see an Ivory soap ad. I wanted to see a Special K ad. I wanted to see any ad. But it was all negative Trump ads. And most of them were really false. Some were correct, actually. Most of them were false. But here's what we're going to do. You got to get out on November 8th. You got to get all your friends out. You got to... Because our country that we love and that we cherish does not win anymore at anything. We're always losing. We're losing with the Iran deal. We're losing with education. We're losing every single thing we lose with. Our military's depleted. Our vets, we love our vets, are not properly taken care of. And we're going to take care of them. We're going to take care of our vets. First time in a long time, and believe me, we are. And folks, we're going to start winning again. We're going to win. We're going to win with our military. We're going to knock the hell out of ISIS. Country legally. We're going to win on our border. We're going to win on trade. We're going to bring our jobs back to this country. We're going to start making things again. We're going to be smart. And if people rip us off,
they are going to suffer the consequences. It's not going to happen anymore. We're going to protect our Second Amendment. We're going to get rid of Obamacare and replace it. Folks, we're going to win so much, you're going to get so sick and tired of winning. You're going to say, Mr. President, sir, please, please, we can't take it. You're winning too much. We don't want to win this much in Jacksonville. We liked it the way it was when we weren't winning. No, I don't think so. We're going to win again, folks. You're going to be so proud of your country. You're going to be so proud of your president. We're going to win, win, win. Folks, we're going to put America first. We're going to make our country safe again. We're going to make our country great again. As sure as you're standing here, thank you. Thank you, Jacksonville. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you, Florida. November 8th, get out and vote. November 8th. Thank you, everybody.